to 13, it reads, "This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one."
Come on, come on, won't be seated. All right, good morning, and welcome to the Bronx region of the New York City Church of Christ. If you're visiting us, we are grateful to have you here. Thank you for joining us. Today we're having a very special service. Today is our graduation Sunday. Yeah, we can clap for that. Where we get to honor some of our graduates who have worked hard to attain the degrees that they have gotten. But it's also special because it's Maurice and Lauren's last Sunday before they go on sabbatical. Woo! Well, for Maurice and Lauren, not for us, but... And so it'll be the last chance for us to hear Maurice preach before he gets his well-deserved rest and comes back in October. But we're gonna what we're gonna do is it's gonna be a little different, but we're gonna transition on to the communion and reflecting on the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus. And so thinking about the cross, especially on a Sunday like today, where we're focused so much on graduation, it got me thinking a lot about how, society can often categorize us and identify us in a way that limits us. Whether it's based on our characteristics, our race, our gender, our life, our achievements, or our success. Even a lot of times based on our levels of schooling, the amount of money that we have, or our positions. And it's not like these things aren't good things, but when we get put into these boxes, it ends up limiting us in what we can do. And it was the same for me. I moved to the United States in 2004, and for a long time I was just known as the Asian kid, and that's all it was, right? And often in the United States, you get just categorized just based on your gender and limited just based on your gender. But when I was growing up in Korea, it was success and it was education that was a big deal. You get categorized by where you went to school and what you did. And I think the cross is so great because it brings freedom from those things. It allows us to break out of those boxes that limit us and contain us, and from the sins that can so easily identify us. In Colossians chapter 3, starting in verse 9, Paul says to the church in Colossae, "Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices, and have put on a new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge and in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you have grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts, and whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." And it's a beautiful thing that we no longer have to worry about who we are, to be identified by what we do in our lives and our characteristics, being defined by our achievements or our failures. I can be defined by God and who God is, his love and how infinite it is for me, and everything else that we have is just a cherry on top. So as we go to God in prayer, let's remember what God has called us out of and the incredible life that he calls us into. So let's go to God in prayer. Lord and Abba, we are grateful for Jesus, for the forgiveness that we found through him. But not just forgiveness, God, but a new life. A new life that is far greater than anything we could have imagined. I pray that as we take the bread that represents his body and the juice that represents his blood, that we are grateful for the new life that we get to live, for the forgiveness that we have found, God, and just that, that we are not a part of this world and its ways anymore, but that we get to be a part of you. Thank you, and I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let your living water flow over my soul. Let your Holy Spirit come and take control of every situation that troubles my mind. All my cares and burdens unto you I roll. All my cares and burdens unto you I roll.
Singing.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
And sing to the Father.
Father, Father, Father.
The Holy Spirit.
First, we are going to pray for our contribution. I know as we're going through, we are giving a special contribution, which again, we can continue to give all week through the end of August. But if you are giving special contribution in person, you can take an envelope from one of the ushers and write your name and address on it and turn in whatever that is. But we do encourage you to continue to give online. If you're visiting with us, we're not asking for you to give, but if you feel in your heart that's what you want to do, then please do. So right now, I'm just going to have a prayer for our contribution, and then we'll continue on with our service. Let's go to God. Almighty God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for allowing us to be here. Thank you once again for giving us a chance to give back to you. Father, that's exactly what contribution is. It's just a part of us giving to you what's already yours, but yet an expression of our gratitude and love to you. Please bless this giving that we have. And I pray, Father, that it will be used to advance your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
I just wanna sit here at your feet, caught up in this holy thank you.
Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Bring all your failures,
bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
All right, let's get this party started. So I asked for less songs so I can have more time to preach to you today, because it'll be 3 months before I preach to you again, and in that time I'm probably going to grow some dreads, get a gold tooth, I don't know, but it's going to be fun. It's good to see everybody here today. We have been doing a series called What's Love Got to Do With It? And we're talking about it because, just as the song said, God so loved the world, we know that, but many times we don't understand that. Many times we can't grasp that. So I want to just talk slow, make sure I'm clear, because I want you to get full of God's love today. You know, it's like when you go to eat at a restaurant, Olive Garden. And you go there at Olive Garden, you sit down, you get the menu, you look at the menu, you say, I want this fettuccine Alfredo with shrimp, I want this chicken masalas, something, whoever it is. And then they go walk away. Then they come back and they bring you some breadsticks. Mm-hmm. And then they bring out some salad. And them breadsticks, probably the best breadsticks on the face of the earth. Them breadsticks so good, you just sit there and you start eating that bread. Then you have some of that salad. And then you're sitting there and you're like, man, I'm stuffed. And then they bring out your food. And then you're like, wait a minute, I don't even want this because I'm full on all this bread that I ate the whole time. You're like, I don't want that stuff. I got to take it because I ordered it, so I'll just put it in a to-go box and take it home and deal with it later. But you're so satisfied because of the bread that you ate. Well, let me say this. Jesus is the bread of life. He is the one that can fulfill you, fill you up, satisfy you, and make you not want any more of that other little stuff that comes later. But the issue is, am I going to get my fill of Jesus, the bread of life? This is why we're talking about love. Because we know it, but we aren't all filled with it like we can be. Why? How do you know that, preacher? Because we don't show it. We've been talking about stuff, and we've learned lessons, because one of the lessons we learned, I'll talk about it in a minute, is you cannot give what you don't have. And if you don't have that bread of life, that love of God in your life, you can't give it to anybody else. So the only way we're gonna learn how to be loving is if, first of all, we accept God's love. Relationships are a blessing and a challenge at the same time. Relationships can be fun, but they can be hard. Relationships can be exciting, but they can be hurtful. Being a Christian is a blessing and a challenge at the same time. It can be fun, it can be challenging. It could be exciting, it could be hurtful. It's no wonder that being a Christian is all about relationships. And this is what we've got to understand, because many people don't. Being a Christian is about your relationships. Number one, you and God. Number two, you and yourself. And then other people. You say, well, wait a minute, that's not what I was taught before. It's supposed to be God and then the church. You're missing the point. First is you and God. And sometimes we think we just got to keep giving to everybody. You need to read the Bible and realize there were times that Jesus had to just go be by himself with God. Jesus could not give what he needed to give until he got what he needed to get. Then if that was Jesus, how much more should we be the same way? But see, we let religion deceive us. Well, I'm not going to be deceived by anybody. Listen, the angels that were in heaven were deceived by Satan and went on his side. How much more can mere men and women like us be deceived by Satan? We've got to understand, we got to take this a lot deeper than I have my quiet time today. It's a whole nother world. See, your relationships say a lot about your spiritual life. How you grew up plays a lot into your spiritual walk with God. You know, if your father was an absent father, you may feel like God is an absentee God. If your father was a harsh father, you may feel like God is a harsh father. If your past relationships were mistrustful, you will feel like the relationships in the trust are in the church are mistrustful. So many times, guys, we bring our past into our present. Now, we don't purposely do that. Say, oh, I'm going to do this on purpose. It's a part of our nature. It's a part of how we act. We don't even realize we do it sometimes. But that's why the Bible says in Romans 12, verse 2, Romans 12, verse 2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. The Bible says that we need to transform our mind, renew our mind. That means we have one way of thinking that needs to change and become a different way of thinking. Now, just because you do something over and over and over again doesn't make it right. And many times we hear something or we think something over and over and we just assume that it's right. So let's take a little inventory of our relationships. So visualize in your mind four or five people that are special to you. Spouse, kids, parents, uncles, aunt, whoever. Just picture in your mind four or five people that are very special to you. These people are your circle of life. Now, as you think about these people, ask yourself this question. Are they valuable to me? Are these relationships worth doing whatever it takes to keep them? And you got to think about this because in your last days of life, what are you going to want with you? All those long hours you put into that job is not going to mean anything. That diploma on your wall, are you going, oh, let me hug this as I'm laying on my bed, on my deathbed? You're not going to want that. That car that we treasure so much, ooh, let me just go sit in my car in my last days. That's not what you're going to want. You're going to want the people that are close to you to be in your life. Now, if those relationships will matter the most then, they should matter the most now. So what can we do to strengthen our relationships? What can we do to strengthen our relationships? You got to ask yourself this. Inventory of your heart. You got to ignore this screen. It's a little shaky today. It's a long night. Ask yourself this. Am I living in God's love? In other words, have I accepted the fact that God loves me regardless of how messed up I may be? Now, before I move on, I want you to think about that for a moment. Have you really accepted the fact that God loves you regardless of whatever flaws and weaknesses you have? You got to ask yourself, does the way I treat people reflect the way God treats me? I'm just going to ignore this right now. So let's review what I've talked about in the few series that we've done so far. First of all, you can't give what you don't have. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness. If you don't accept that from God, you can't give it. You can't give what you don't accept about yourself. Again, if you can't accept, you know what, even though I have insecurities, I'm still loved by God. If you can't accept that, then the next person you talk to who has insecurities, you won't accept them. If you can't accept it about yourself, you can't accept it about them. If you can't accept that God is patient with you, even though you are impatient, then you won't be patient with somebody else. You can't accept what you don't know. And this is important. You can't accept what you don't know. What I'm telling you is this. What I'm talking about, what I'm trying to help us go in regards to our love, this is uncharted territory for many of us. Because many of us didn't grow up in such a loving family. Not that it had to be bad, but myself personally, we loved each other, but it was never verbally talked about. Those words did not come out. When you didn't get a whooping, you were loved. That's how we understood it. Ooh, I got off of that one, because I love you. Or when they were this, I say whooping. Y'all know what I mean when I say whooping, right? I'm sorry, in timeout. Only timeout we got is when they took a break from whooping us. That was our timeout. But loving people isn't always easy. Some relationships are a challenge to love. So as I talk about this, we need to let a few things refresh our minds. What I mean is this. We need to be refreshed that we're actually finally talking about these issues in the church. We need to talk about love because there is a strong lack of love. Not that people don't love each other, but we're just not loving the way God wants us to love. So I'm not saying we don't love. I'm not saying that. But it's not always, as the Bible says, love as I have loved you. We need to be grateful that this is an area we see the church now growing in. But then thirdly, we need to see that this is something that we as an individual need to change. Because too many times we talk about the church needs to do this, the church needs to do that. We are the church. So if the church needs to grow in this, that means we need to grow in this. It's not easy to love people that hurt you or cause you pain in some kind of way. Some people may even think, how can I actually forgive certain people the way they did me wrong in my life? They've scarred me mentally, physically, spiritually, but yet I'm supposed to forgive them? Well, Jesus did. Even on the cross as he's being crucified, Father, please forgive them. Now, why could he do that? Because he was so full of love. If you're not full of enough love, then you can't give forgiveness to those that hurt you. Is it easy? No. We're not going to pretend, oh, just go do it. No. But the only way we can get to that point is if we start embracing God's love, understanding God's love. Then we will progress, grow into being that kind of person. You're not just going to forgive everybody instantly. No way in the world is that going to happen in reality. But yet, if you're walking with God every single day, you will grow more and more into being that loving person. Let's remember what happened in Luke chapter 7, verse 47. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little loves little. Here's a sinful woman, and there's a Pharisee. This sinful woman saw her sin, and her tears flowed like Niagara Falls. She was crying. She was broken by her sin. And then you had this religious person, this Pharisee. He went to school to learn spiritual things. He was an elite person. But yet, when he even tried to acknowledge his sin, his face wasn't wet with tears. It was dry like the Sahara Desert. There was two different hearts responding. Why? Because one was in touch with God's love, and the other was in touch with religion. Religion doesn't break your heart. Religion makes you into something different. Look at what it says in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 8. Love never fails. Now, here's a catch. The verb Paul uses here for the word fail is used as to describe the demise of a flower as it falls to the ground. It withers and decays. So the word fails, it carries a meaning of death and abomination. But Paul says here that God's love never fails. God's love never falls to the ground. God's love never withers. God's love never decays. He says, by nature, God's love is permanent. It describes love in many different interpretations of the Bible. The New Language Interpretation, it says, love will last forever. MSG, it never dies. It never ends. Love is eternal. God's love will never come to an end. Love never fails. No matter how you look at it, it tells you how God's love will never fail. Governments fail, but God's love lasts forever. Crowns are temporary, but God's love is eternal. Your money will run out, but God's love will never run out. You say, well, how does God love like this? No man or woman could ever love like this. You're right, no man or woman could, but God is not a man or woman like us. Unlike us, God's love never fails. His love is different than ours. So let me drive this home. I don't want y'all going to sleep on my last day here. Man's love depends on the receiver of the love. Now stay with me here. We're going to go a little bit deeper. The way we love depends on the receiver, me. The way I love depends on me. You know, there'll be 1,000 people in my life, and I will not feel the same about each of them. My love is going to be determined by their appearance, how they treat me, how they treat my kids, how they treat the people that I'm close to. Even when you find a few people that you really, really, really love, your love for them will fluctuate based on your emotions, how you feel, what's going on. How people treat you will affect how you love them. So the receiver regulates the love between people. Y'all follow me so far? Makes sense, right? That is not how God works. We have no impact on God's love for us. The love God has for us is born within him, not what he finds within us. His love isn't spontaneous. Does God love us because of our goodness, because of our kindness, because of our faithfulness? Oh, you're so faithful, so I love you. No, that's not how he works. It says in 1 John 4:10, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Now this should comfort us, because God's love does not hinge on your love. How much God loves you does not increase because of how much you say you love God. God's love for you does not decrease because of those bad days you have when you don't love him as much. See, you don't determine God's love, because God is not like us. Our feeling, man, we determine how we feel about people based on how they treat us. God doesn't do that. Your good days and your bad days, it's the same to God. He still loves you the same amount, whether you're doing such a great job or you're not doing such a great job. Your goodness does not enhance his love, nor does your weakness lessen his love. Now, I'm going to say that because this is where we got to renew our mind. Because some of us would think, I didn't have a good quiet time today. I'm not as close to God as I should be. I didn't read my Bible this whole week, so I'm not doing well spiritually. Whether you read your Bible every day for an hour or you read it once that whole week, you didn't change how God feels about you. Now, that's going to take a while to reprogram and transform some of y'all thinking, because that's not how we always thought. Because religion has taught us something different. Religion has taught us, if I don't have a certain amount of time in the Bible and praying every day, I'm not a good Christian. And some of y'all who ain't saying nothing, you know what I'm talking about. That's why you ain't saying nothing. But the fact is, I don't see my daughter every day now that she's married, but I still love her every day. Just because I don't see her or talk to her every day doesn't mean I don't love her every day. And this is where, remember when I started? Our past comes in and makes us view God a certain way. We need to look at what the Bible says and view it the way the Bible says God is. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 7 and 8, look at what Moses said to the people here. The Lord did not set his heart on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other nations, for you were the smallest of all nations. Rather, it was simply that the Lord loves you, and he was keeping the oath he had sworn to your ancestors. That is why the Lord rescued you with such a strong hand from your slavery and from the oppressive hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. What is he saying? God loves you because he chose to love you. You didn't do anything to make God love you. God loves you because he chose to love you. Now, you keep hearing me talking about how much God loves you. I want you to embrace it, because this is what you got to give to other people. So when somebody comes to you and they're having a hard time and you're like, I don't know what to say. I don't know what words of wisdom. You don't need to say nothing. Show them God's love. That's the answer to the problem. He loves you when you don't feel lovingly. He loves you when no one else loves you. He loves you when you feel all alone. He loves you when you got divorced. He loves you when you had a hard time with a family member. He loves you when you lost a family member. He loves you the day you wake up and you're a cranky, snotty, angry person because your back hurt, your blood pressure up, you missed the train, you spent money on an Uber that you didn't need. He still loves you regardless of all your personal drama. You say, well, wait, that's right. That's all you can say. The fact is, God loves you so much. Now, if you can't embrace that, if every single one of us could embrace that, imagine how we would change. Imagine how just this room would be so different if you accepted how much God loves you, regardless of how jacked up you are. And I say that in a nice way. But regardless, if you can accept that he loves you like that, then you know what? You can look around this room and accept everybody else. Regardless of what they look like, how they act, how long you've known them to be that way. Because God knew, he knows the way we are for a long time. And he still has loved us. This is God's heart. In Romans chapter 9, verse 25, in the Message version. And get this, the Message version says it very clearly. I'll call nobodies and make them somebodies. I'll call the unloved and make them beloved. In the place where they yelled out, you're nobody, they're calling you God's living children. Amen. What does he say? We were all nobodies at some point. But he said, now you somebody because he chose you. You didn't do anything to become a somebody. He made you a somebody. So you know what that means? That means when some person comes to you with a problem, don't look at them as a nobody. They're a somebody because of who God says they are. We've got to understand, we've got to just transform our minds. We have got to become the loving people that God wants us to be, but we will not until we accept it first from God, so then we can become the loving people he wants us to be. Jeremiah 31, verse 3. God told them, I'll never quit loving you and never will. Expect love, love, and more love. Do you know what this means? It means we have a deep well of love to draw from. Whenever you are thirsty for God's love, there's a deep, deep well. He will continue to love you. You know when you get thirsty? As hot as it's been lately, you know, you go outside, it's hot. When you start to get thirsty, it actually starts to mess with your mind. That's why, like, people in the desert, they see a mirage. It's something that, it's not really there, but they're just so dehydrated, they think it's there. Well, why do you think Jesus says he is living water? So you never have to be dehydrated. So you can realize what you think is good for you in the world is not good for you. Because what you have is living water to quench you and to help you bathe in it, to help you have that. And then when you get out, you got the bread of life. Jesus is there to satisfy you all around. We have got to understand, sometimes the way we think can be destructive. So we've got to transform our minds. Let Jesus be the living water he says he wants to be for us, so we don't have to long and thirst for the world. If you're not drinking from Jesus, you're drinking from the world. So, remember this, love is fruit. When you embrace God's love, you live in his spiritual orchard. Now, what's the first fruit you see in God's spiritual orchard? Look in Galatians chapter 5. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. The first fruit of that spiritual orchard is love. Fruit is love. Fruit of whom? Of your hard work, of your faith? No, it's the fruit of the Spirit. Again, you can't work enough to be loving like Jesus. That's not how it operates. You can't do enough things to make yourself loving. You have to accept the love in order to give the love. Now, this is important. Well, all of it is, but listen to this. John 15, verse 5. Yes, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever lives in me and I in him shall produce a large crop of fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Now in nature, the role of the branch is to bear fruit. Branches don't exert a lot of energy. They just basically sit there. I mean, you never seen a branch freak out like, oh, I gotta get this apple out. I'm stressing to get this apple out of here. No, branches just sit there. But Jesus said again in John 15, verse 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever lives in me and I in him shall produce a large crop of fruit. What is he saying? God is the one that bears the fruit. Our job is just to stay put. See, the vine is the one that does it. The branch is just to stay put, to stay attached. That's our whole job, to stay attached to Jesus so those nutrients, so that fruit, so that love can come through us out into the world. All we have to do is stay close to God. God is not saying go out and do all these 15, 16 things. He says, no, you just need to stay tied in to the vine, to Jesus. Stay attached. Don't leave. Don't go anywhere. When the storms come, it's going to beat you up a little bit, but you don't need to leave. You don't need to fall off the vine. You need to stay connected to the vine. So you got to ask yourself, how connected am I to Jesus? Do I need somebody to help me stay connected to Jesus? Or is Jesus Lord, and you know what? Regardless of how I'm treated, I'm going to stay faithful to Jesus. I promise you, there's going to be people that hurt your feelings. Not even on purpose, but hurt your feelings. Hurt you mentally, spiritually, physically. There's going to be people that hurt you financially. The question is, are you going to let them detach you from the vine, or are you going to stay connected to Jesus? Because the moment one person hurts you, well, the church did this to me. Did the church actually do it, or did that one little leaf do it to you? You know, before we read 1 Corinthians 13, and I would insert my name in there where it says, you know, Maurice is patient, Maurice is kind, Maurice. I got through two of those and everybody started laughing. And I was talking to Murray. I was like, man, that's just kind of weird. Like, why would they laugh when I said Maurice is patient, Maurice is kind? But then maybe you think about yourself too. So I got another one for us. Let's do this. 1 Corinthians 13. But instead of saying my name, we're going to say Christ in whatever your name is. So let me do it like this. Christ in Maurice is patient. Christ in Wendy is kind. Christ in Anna is not envious. Christ in Scott does not boast. You see how quiet it's getting? Ain't nobody laughing now, is it? Ha ha ha, very funny. Christ in Stanley is not proud. Let's do this again. Let's go on to the next one. Christ in Millie is not rude. Christ in Juan is not self-seeking. Christ in Sebastian is not easily angered. Now, half of y'all, I hope you don't know my name. I don't want my name on the screen. Here, the fact is, Christ in you will become those things. It's not about you alone. When it's hard to be kind, remember God's kindness to you. When you have little to no patience, remember God's patience with you. When it's hard to forgive somebody, remember the times God has forgiven you. God's love never fails. We need to stay connected to the vine, that's Jesus. And your life, your love will change not just you, but those around you. We're going to be on sabbatical for 3 months. Amen. And I'm going to miss you guys. Really, I am. But I'm coming back. God willing, we're coming back. It's just some time to get refreshed, time to get energized, time to get ready. But here's what I want to challenge the church with for 3 months. I want to come back to a more loving church than is already here. I want to come back to a group that I'm not coming back and they're like, ooh, you got to get with this brother and sister. Ooh, you got to tell this sister to leave the church because she's just acting a fool. Ooh, you got to get... Let's not come back to that. Let's come back to something that's more loving than what we're leaving. Something where we made a decision, I'm going to treat everybody different because I see myself different. I'm accepting how much God loves me, and you know what? I'm going to start accepting other people as well. It doesn't mean you let people walk on you. Jesus didn't do that. It doesn't mean you let people take advantage of you. Jesus didn't do that. But many times in the Bible, it says Jesus looked at them and loved them and told them the truth. Guys, we can do that as long as it's the way Jesus did it. So I want to encourage us with these last words. Let us be different. Let us embrace love. Let us give love. Let this be what the Bronx region is known for, the Church of Christ's love. In Jesus' name.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Maurice. We appreciate that. Hopefully you guys feel stretched in love, right? This is it's always a challenging message to love more, but hopefully you feel refreshed, right? That it's not about us, that we need to all go on a sabbatical, right? It's not, we don't need to take 3 months off, but we need to spend that Sabbath weekly, right? With God, daily with God. God, fill me with your love. Fill me with what you have for me. So again, we appreciate it. We will miss you, Maurice. Again, let's let him get his rest. Let's be praying for him. And we're going to do that too. We're not going to close with a song today. We're all going to close in prayer. But as we're doing that, I got a few closing announcements. We're going to get our graduates to come up on stage. So if you guys could start lining up with my wife over there, and then as you guys start coming up, do you guys know who graduated? We're going from high school and up, the graduates. You guys could start coming down. I guess you can mention some of their names. And,
okay, so our graduates are Anginelli Restituyo.
Just start lining up over there. You should know who you are.
Annika's not here. Annika Richards, Jade Jenkins, Alanis Gonzalez, Serge Safori, Francesca Lopez, Jacqueline Palacios.
All right. So I'm gonna go grab the gifts. As they're lining up, we'll all clap for them. We'll play a little song for them, and then we'll end in prayer. But just again, just a reminder for everyone that for the summer we will be back here every Sunday, and we'll have a bunch of different guest preachers and speakers coming here. There will be no midweek, so that gives you more and more of a chance to love people. So no midweeks for the summer. Just hang out and love people. And also this summer, we know it's the summer camp for the teens and the preteens, but next week is the last week to register. So if you have not registered, please register this week if you want a preteen or a teenager to go to camp. And then the last one is for the singles. You guys are going to go to this conference that's in Anaheim, California, if you can make it. The information is up on the screen. But the rest of the singles just hang out here. Also, this is Lou and Ingrid Bonilla's last, Ingrid's last service in the Bronx, right? Is that what I heard? Lou's shaking his head. Not yet? You're not moving? Or I don't know, maybe. Somebody told me that you're moving. Well, Lou, just say hello to Lou and Ingrid. They're here. Maybe they're moving. Maybe they're going on vacation. But do we got all the graduates there? All right, so start announcing their names. I'll start giving them out. Let's play a little song for them. Let's clap it up for our graduates.
Restituyo, graduating from our Savior's Lutheran High School, heading to college. We have also Jay Jenkins, Alanis Gonzalez, graduating from high school as well. We have Serge Safori, bachelor's in liberal arts, and Jacqueline Palacios from the Police Academy. We celebrate you guys for your hard work, for your effort, and keep fighting the good fight. Michael wasn't here.
Yeah, we're missing a few. So if we could actually all just stand up. Let's give them one last round of applause. all to close in prayer. So for you guys, we're going to, it's not a religious thing, but it's a biblical thing to raise our hands in prayer. God has shown us that throughout the Bible, that we praise God by raising our hands. And for you guys, too, just in case you feel embarrassed doing that, there's some balloons up there, so you can look up, you can close your eyes so you don't feel weird. We got you balloons, but they're up there. But we want to start off by just taking a moment of silence, too, and just praying. Maybe we'll get some like background music just to get us in there just worshiping God. So we're going to pray for these guys as they go off to the next point in their life. We're going to pray for the Hooks as they're on a sabbatical. But we're going to pray for our church. But as we're doing that, we're just worshiping God. So you're going to start off with prayers in your own mind, in your own hearts. And then I'm going to start praying. If you agree with anything that I say, you could say amen. But let's raise our hands, lift it high. Let's close our eyes. Let's have a little moment of silence and worshiping God and praying God. And then we'll send us out to love the world the way Christ Jesus loved us. Amen. God, we lift our hands to you right now, God. We pray with lifted hands that you bless these graduates up on stage, God, as they worked hard to graduate college and high school and moving on to somewhere new, God. We pray that your blessing be upon us. Be upon them, be upon this whole church, God. As we're all going off, we go out into the world, God, that we can show Christ to those around us, God. That we can feel your love living in us, God. We pray right now, God, for the things that we don't know what to pray, God. Fill our hearts on what it is that we need to pray, God. We consecrate our lives to you, God. We consecrate the church to you, God. We consecrate our careers, our money, our finances, our health, God. We pray for all of those in need, God. We put a special prayer out for Zabari, who just had a surgery this week, God. For all of those who are sick, all of those who are moving, all of those who are transitioning in life, God. Help us receive your love right now, God. Help us to give back the worship to you that you deserve, that you are more than we can think of, ask, or imagine. Thank you for forgiving us of our sins, God. Thank you for filling us with your Holy Spirit, God. Again, we pray that your Spirit be upon all of us, God. We love you, we praise you, we worship you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen, guys. Enjoy the summer. Maurice and Lauren, enjoy your sabbatical. Guys, enjoy your new journey in life. Enjoy this time of fellowship. Thank you guys for coming out. We'll see you next Sunday. Have a blessed day. Amen. You are dismissed. On your way out, they are selling some food for camp.